I've never heard a group get so quiet all of a sudden. Good evening. My name is Jean Quam, and I'm the Dean of the College of Education and Human Development. And on behalf of our college, and especially the Tucker Center, it's my pleasure to welcome you to their annual Fall Distinguished Lecture. And I want to thank you all for being here tonight. Since its inception in 1993, the Tucker Center was established as a result of generous endowment from the University of Minnesota alum and 1945 CEHD graduate, Dr. Dorothy Tucker. The Tucker Center has fulfilled its threefold mission. First, to conduct research on the impact of sports in the lives of girls and women. Second, to provide first-rate educational opportunities for students. And third, to engage in community outreach and public service. The Fall Lecture Series brings all parts of their mission together by creating a public forum that allows the best and the brightest scholars and educators from around the globe to share their insights and expertise on important and timely issues related to women's involvement in sports. Tonight's great conversation is no exception, and I think we have a real treat for you tonight. Mary Jo wrote this speech for me, and I noticed that in the column it says, you might want to say something about the Emmy here. No, it doesn't. It says, you might want to talk about how wonderful the Tucker Center is. And I actually don't need a reminder about that. The Tucker Center is a real gem in our college. It is a leader in terms of defining the research about women and girls in sport, and we are extremely proud of the work that they do. But before we get to the main event, each year the Tucker Center awards the Edith Mueller Scholarship winner. The purpose of the Edith Mueller Park and Recreation Memorial Award is to acknowledge the important contribution of undergraduate students who are pursuing a degree in recreation, park, and leisure studies, and encourages them to deepen their commitment to the profession. The award also honors the memory of Edith Mueller, a U of M Parks and Recreation major before her untimely death in 1982. To present the scholarship winners tonight is Dr. Connie Magnuson, the director of the School of Kinesiology's Park and Recreation Program. Connie.
Thank you, Dean Quam. This year, we are pleased to have two recipients for the Edith Mueller Scholarship, and I will ask them to please come to the stage at this time. Are you there?
Yeah.
All right. Laura Stegan graduated with a degree in occupational therapy and is currently pursuing a degree in recreation, park, and leisure studies in order to attain her dream job. Laura has been volunteering in a homeless shelter since she was in high school and is very passionate about serving this population. She leads support groups and recreational activities in order to inspire those around her. She is a full-time art teacher, along with being a student, and is striving to achieve her dream of providing recreational therapy in a homeless shelter. Laura came to the University of Minnesota to receive a transplant and has chosen to make this her academic home to complete her studies. Congratulations, Laura, on being a recipient of the Edith Mueller Scholarship. Kayla Vanderhagen is an adventurer at heart. Upon entering the Recreation, Park, and Leisure Studies program, Kayla naturally gravitated to the outdoor recreation minor and, in particular, to my Dive Belize course. I had the privilege of getting to know Kayla on the Belize trip and could see then her interest in global issues and other cultures and the enjoyment and exciting activities that we did on this trip. Diving, kayaking, hiking, ziplining, it was awesome. Kayla took an interest in how outdoor programs operate in other countries and would like to pursue this as her career path. Kayla could not be with us this evening as she is off in Venezuela for the semester, experiencing and learning yet another culture. We are pleased to have Kayla's mother and father on, here to present or to receive the award on her behalf. Victoria Ladwick, thank you so much for coming tonight, and congratulations to Kayla.
Thanks, Connie. Now I'd like to recognize and ask you to join me in saying a warm thank you to Edith Mueller's mother, Mike Mueller, and her sister, Carrie Fritz, for all their generous support that you've given to the Tucker Center over the years, right down here. Dr. Lavoie will serve as the moderator this evening and will introduce tonight's two distinguished speakers. Nicole Lavoie is the Associate Director of the Tucker Center. Dr. Lavoie is an internationally recognized scholar whose research examines the social psychology of sports and addresses important questions that make a significant difference in the lives of sports stakeholders, particularly girls and women. Dr. Lavoie exemplifies the mission of the college through her excellence in teaching, research, and public outreach. Her most recent scholarly efforts focus on employment barriers experienced by female coaches, including the groundbreaking study, Women in College Coaching Research Series, and Report Card. In 2015, Dr. Lavoie received the CEHD Distinguished Teaching Award. She currently serves on the National Advisory Boards for the Women's Sports Foundation, ESPNW, and the Alliance of Women Coaches. I couldn't be prouder than to have Dr. Nicole Lavoie in our college and being the moderator this evening.
Okay, thank you, Dean Quam. I would also like to recognize the Muellers for their generosity and longtime support of the Tucker Center. It's always nice to see you every fall, so thank you for being here with us. And before I get going, I'd also like to thank members of the Tucker team who are around and about, Jonathan Sweet, Anna Baith, and Marnie Kinnaird. Without them, this event does not happen. And this is one of the best parts about our job, is we get to work with top-rate students and faculty in the Tucker Center. So thanks to them. And finally, I know that I speak on behalf of the Tucker team that we all appreciate the support of you, Dean Quam, and the College of Education and Human Development. So thank you for being here with us tonight. It's my pleasure to welcome all of you, a lot of familiar faces in the audience, faculty, community members, and students alike. And it's fun to welcome you to what I know will be a thought-provoking and evening of insight and discussion that will situate the current and future landscape of women's sport within the historical context of women's sport research with two of the most well-known sport and gender scholars in the world. But before I introduce our panelists, I want to set the stage for you with some statistics around women's sport and begin to help us answer the question, if in the last year, was it truly a tipping point for women's sport or not? Over the last year, and particularly this summer, you might have noticed there have been a number of significant and groundbreaking occurrences in four key areas of women's sport, which include viewership, sponsorship, leadership, and female athletic achievements. We know that media coverage of female athletes is limited compared to their male counterparts. And based on the data, we also know that broadcast coverage is declining. Yet, despite a near media blackout, interest in watching women's sport is skyrocketing. The Tucker Center gathers data to dispel false narratives around women's sport. For example, that the myth that no one is interested in women's sport. To counter this particular myth, 2 years ago, we launched the Here's Proof campaign, a social media campaign where people, and I'm inviting all of you to participate, if you are so inclined, to post pictures that show fan interest in women's sport with the hashtag Here's Proof, like this photo of the 2015 Women's World Cup. Or for this picture that I took over last weekend at the Gopher Women's Volleyball sellout crowd against Wisconsin. Or for this picture about the Gopher Women's Hockey Team last season when they won the national championship. So as you can see, that viewership for the Women's World Cup eclipsed some of the most prominent men's sports events, including the 2015 Stanley Cup Finals, the World Series, and the NBA Finals Game 7. And this was an infographic that Marnie put together over the summer. In addition to professional sports, attendance for the NCAA Women's Basketball Final and viewership of fans across the season has eclipsed 11 million viewers for the seventh year in a row. In the top 25 highest-rated televised college sports games in the last year on major news networks, two of the top 25 were the Women's Basketball March Madness Finals, which outrated some of the most popular football bowl series games. Also, this year on ESPNW, a digital brand extension of ESPN, which is focused on serving the female sport fan, now in its sixth year, ESPNW had 10.8 million unique page visitors, marking a 40% increase in traffic from the year before. The next area that we've had significant achievements in women's sport that might indicate a tipping point is in the area of women in positions of power, including sports unions, officiating, coaching, and broadcasting. Here you see a picture of Michelle Roberts, who became the executive director of the National Basketball Players Association this year. She is the first woman to hold that position and the first woman to head a major professional sports union in North America. In April, the NFL hired Sarah Thomas as its first female official. While women coaching women has been steadily declining in the last 40 years since Title IX, from 90% in 1972 to around 40% today, recently we've seen women coaching male athletes at the highest levels of professional tennis, football, and basketball. Here you see Dr. Jen Welter, who became the first female to be an NFL coaching intern for the Arizona Cardinals. In this picture, you see Becky Hammon, former WNBA star, who became the first female assistant coach in the NBA. And not just for any team, but for the 2013 and 2014 NBA champions, the San Antonio Spurs. And in this picture, you see Emily Mauresmo, a former pro on the women's tennis tour who now coaches Andy Murray, currently ranked number 2 on the men's professional tennis tour. And lastly, in the area of sport leadership, just this fall, 2-time Olympic softball player Jessica Mendoza became the first female analyst to call a Major League Baseball game on ESPN, and in early October became the first woman to call a nationally televised Major League Baseball playoff game. So seeing women in positions of power at the highest levels of sport may help change outdated stereotypes about women, gender, and leadership. The third area that we've seen significant and key landmarks in women's sport is in the area of sponsorship and corporate attention. Some of you may have seen, and just a raise of hand, how many people have watched this video, the Like a Girl? Okay, so you're among the 58 million people who have viewed this video on YouTube. This was the Like a Girl campaign from Procter & Gamble, which disrupted stereotypes about what it means to throw like a girl and the harmful effects that it has on girls when this becomes a negative stereotype. Similarly, the I Will What I Want Under Armour campaign currently underway reflects the trend of corporate America in using sport as a way to promote women's empowerment. And lastly, in the area of corporate sponsorship, some of you might know who Maria Sharapova is. She is a ranked tennis player on the women's tour. She banked $29.7 million this year as the 26th highest paid athlete in the world. Sharapova is the highest paid female athlete in the world for the 11th straight year, $7 million in prize winning, and $23 million in endorsements. So corporate America is paying attention. And lastly, but certainly not the least important, are the recent numerous amazing performances of female athletes, which has garnered the rare attention of the sport media. Starting last summer, Monet Davis became the first girl to win and to pitch a no-hitter in the Little League World Series. Just last week, our own Minnesota Lynx. Let's hear it for the Lynx. All right. Won their third WNBA title in 5 years. The WNBA playoffs broke all attendance and viewer records and broke a record attendance game for the fifth game at Target Center for a WNBA final at 19,000 plus fans. Maybe some of you were there. And what you may not know is that the Lynx game more than tripled the audience that tuned in to the Major League playoff game of the Royals versus the Astros that same night. You didn't hear that in the media too often. In May, Ronda Rousey donned the cover of Sports Illustrated. And for those of you who follow the covers of Sports Illustrated, this is really rare. Less than 4% of all the covers feature women. And that includes the swimsuit issue. So Rousey was proclaimed, as you can see here, the most dominant athlete in the world, period. As the reigning UFC bantamweight champion, she has won her last four fights in 130 seconds. So that's pretty fast. And generated the most pay-per-view purchases of any fighter in the UFC ever. Here's her picture of her in action on the mat. Also, we have Serena Williams this summer, who vied for a Grand Slam in tennis. The first one to contend for a Grand Slam since 1988, when Steffi Graf won the Grand Slam. While she didn't win the Slam, she currently has won 36 Grand Slam titles and is considered by many the greatest female tennis player of all time in the open era. Now, you're probably sitting there thinking, is she going to talk about the Women's World Cup? Yes, I am, because I would be remiss if I didn't include the Women's World Cup team, who won its unprecedented third World Cup title in July by defeating Japan and breaking all viewership records. Carly Lloyd became the first player to score a hat trick, and for those of you, that's three goals, in 16 minutes in the World Cup final, and many argue it will go down as one of the greatest individual performances in any World Cup game ever. And Abby Wambach holds the world record for the most international goals scored in soccer history. So these key landmark accomplishments have spurred questions from sport journalists, fans, students, and advocates of women's sport to ask. Was this summer of 2015 a tipping point for women's sport? Was it or is it indeed the year of the female athlete? And will this unprecedented attention last and be sustained? To help us answer these important questions, we now turn to two internationally known scholars in the area of gender and sport, Drs. Mary Jo Kane and Pat Griffin. Their past and current work as sport researchers and advocates of women's sport will be illuminating and help us all think about where we've been, as well as situate the current and future landscape of women's sport in a broader historical context. So I am now my pleasure to introduce our panelists. Our first panelist is Professor Pat Griffin. If you want to come on up, Pat. Pat Griffin, Professor Emeritus in the School of Social Justice, the Social Justice Education Program at the University of Massachusetts Amherst, and former Director of It Takes a Team, education campaign for lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender issues in sport, an initiative of the Women's Sport Foundation. In 1998, Griffin wrote the groundbreaking book, Strong Women, Deep Closets, Lesbians and Homophobia in Sports. For the past 25 years, Pat has led seminars on diversity issues and lesbian and gay issues in athletics at numerous colleges and universities, as well as at coaches and athletic administrators association meetings around the US and Canada. She is acknowledged as one of the pioneers, advocates, and leaders in addressing LGBT issues in sport. And I've had the pleasure of listening to her many times, and it never gets old. I could do it 20 more times, and I hope I get the chance to. Please give a warm Minnesota welcome to Pat Griffin. Our next panelist is my colleague and professor and director of the Tucker Center for Research on Girls and Women, Mary Jo Kane. She is also an internationally recognized scholar who has published extensively on media representations of athletic females and is one of the nation's leading experts on the social and political implications of Title IX. In 1996, Professor Kane was awarded the first endowed chair related to women in sport, the Dorothy McNeil Tucker Chair for Women in Exercise Science and Sport. In 2014, Professor Kane was named, along with Professor Griffin, as one of the 100 most influential sport educators by the Institute for International Sport. That's pretty good. Professor Kane has appeared on the Today Show, National Public Radio, and has had her work cited recently in the New York Times, the Washington Post, and the USA Today. Please welcome my colleague, Professor Mary Jo Kane.
Can you all see us? Can you see us? Okay.
Now I have my moderator hat on. So to begin, I would like to start by stating what an honor and a privilege it is to be on the stage with the both of you. I would not be sitting in this chair and doing what I'm doing without your work and mentorship and leadership, and I think I speak on behalf of many in this room, so thank you. Okay, so let's start. Let's personalize this just a little bit. I'm going to put your, this is the historic book, well-loved and dog-eared down there for a minute. How did you both get interested in pursuing work in gender and sport? Pat, do you want to start us off?
Sure. I think like most people who have a passion, a personal passion for work or sports, it started with my own experience as a girl who was would have been called in my era a tomboy. Now, thankfully, would just be called a girl who loves sports, an athlete. That was me. Any sport, I was there. I wanted to play. And I learned really quickly that it was my opportunities in sports would not be the same as the boys that I played with in the neighborhood. As soon as we got to seventh grade, they went on to JV teams and on into high school varsity teams, and everybody came to watch them play. And I was suddenly found myself playing with all girls, and we had play days and sports days and honor teams. But we didn't, in all cases, we had opportunities that were diminished in terms of when you compare them to what was going on for the boys. But I still played. I played field hockey and basketball and swam at the University of Maryland back in the day when you could actually be a three-sport athlete at a Division I school. Probably could never pull that off now. But it was the same thing. I mean, we played in an old rundown gym where it was so small that when you took an out-of-bounds ball on the end line, you had to put your one foot against the wall. That was part of the rules for that court. Mm. And the guys played in Cole Fieldhouse, which is not even used anymore, but it was a huge, arena for basketball. And so we didn't have a swim coach for the women's team. We had a senior on the team who would be our coach. And so I actually coached the University of Maryland swim team when I was a senior. So that can't be a good thing. And so I think my interest in gender and sport started there. When I was at the university getting my master's degree, I was very interested in doing all of my, whatever class I was taking, I wanted to focus on women's sports. And my professors were all men. And I stumbled, literally stumbled on a woman in the women's locker room, Ellen Gerber, who was an eminent sports scholar. And her specialty was women's sports. But she was not allowed to teach graduate courses at the university. I don't understand the politics of all of that, but she was teaching activity classes. And so we struck up a conversation, and she told me what her specialties were. And I was just kind of stunned that I had to find her by accident in the women's locker room instead of in the classroom teaching classes, you know, graduate classes. So I started taking independent studies with her and with her partner, Pearl Berlin, who was teaching guest courses at Smith College because she was not, you know, on the graduate faculty at UMass, and thus started my actual scholarly pursuit of, you know, looking at gender and sport and feminism. It was back in the 70s, so I was a budding feminist and beginning to think of myself as a white person in relationship to racism. So there were all kinds of things happening in my life that were focused around my interest in sport that all grew out of my own personal experience.
Wow. How about you, Professor Kane? How did you get interested in work related to gender and sport initially?
Well, it was very much like what Professor Griffin just said, which is I grew up in central Illinois in the 50s and 60s, and I, too, was the neighborhood tomboy. I loved playing sports. I played football, basketball, and baseball with my two brothers and the neighborhood boys. I went to a small Catholic school, and we all more or less lived in the same neighborhood, too. And so the kids that I went to school with were also the kids that I played sports with after school. And like Pat, when it was time for me to go to high school, I knew that I could no longer play those sports, and I certainly couldn't continue to play them with the neighborhood boys, because then it was time for me to think about dating them, which seemed so bizarre. It was bizarre. And so I did something which I think a lot of girls did, not very well, and I can't even believe I'm going to say this to you out loud, which is that I was a cheerleader. For 2 years, and I was a complete disaster because I always had I love football, and I always had my back to the football games, cheering and being ridiculous, and I always wanted to turn around and like be critiquing why they should have thrown it to the tight end instead of, you know, down the field, because they would all, anyway. So so then I went to undergraduate school, and I was a double major. I was a sociology major and a cultural anthropologist, and I too thought of myself then in those days as, and still do, as a feminist, and was very interested in issues around gender and its relationship to power. And then I heard about this thing called sports sociology, which was just taking off at the University of Illinois, and so I went and got my master's degree and PhD there, and the opportunity to be able to take my passion and love, which is sports, all kinds of sports, women's sports, men's sports, but to be able to make a career to analyze sports, to think about sports, to write about sports was just magnificent, a magnificent opportunity. And, which I did not really realize until we were talking earlier today, my co-mentor at the University of Illinois, who was one of the founding fathers of sports sociology and one of the best theorists and scholars I've ever been around, is a man named John Loy. And as it turned out, John Loy, you can finish the punchline here.
Well, John Loy was my advisor for my master's degree.
So we were trained by one of the very best minds out there in the business.
Interesting.
Yeah.
So how did it first happen that your work started intersecting? When did you meet? Because when I was rereading your book a little bit today, Pat, in the acknowledgments, came out in 1998, you're, you know, young scholars at this point, and you acknowledge Dr. Kane in the acknowledgments as Batgirl.
Oh, no.
You might have forgotten that, but I'm like, ooh, this
sorry.
Is good.
I'm sorry.
Okay. So I don't know what superhero you were, but clearly your work had intersected. So when did this first happen?
Oh, my God.
Cheerleading and Batgirl.
I first learned of, I knew of Dr. Kane's work, her work around media images of women in sport, and I was so struck by it. It was such amazing, enlightening work, and I was, I don't really remember exactly. I think it was, I was at a conference, and she was making a presentation, and she had these slides of the covers of media guides for college women's sports teams, and it was just stunning, some of the sexism that was embedded in these media guides covers. And the worst one was a school that shall remain nameless, mostly because I can't remember the name. Someplace in Louisiana, right?
I think like Southwestern State, Louisiana, okay. Or something.
And it was actually a cover of the women's basketball team dressed as Playboy bunnies, complete with ears and little bunny tails. And the whole narrative of the whole thing is these girls can play, comma, boys. And the basketball arena was referred to as the Pleasure Palace. I mean, it was just unbelievable. And so when I saw that, I wanted to use that particular slide in another presentation that I was doing. So I had to call Mary Jo and ask if I permission to use the slide. And so that was really, I think, the first time we'd actually talked.
Right.
So I knew of your work and admired it from afar, and so that was the first time. You very graciously gave me not only that slide, but several others, gave me permission to use them, you know, in my presentations. And I think that was where we met.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think that's
is that your recollection as well?
Well, yeah, and we were talking a little bit earlier today, too, which is that in the early 90s, there is a woman named Laurel Dagnon. She was at Slippery Rock at the time.
Right.
And we were all going to, again, there were the few sort of handful of sport and gender scholars around the country, and we would go and have like the women in sport research session at a major conference. Laurel Dagnon said, no, we should have our own conferences where we have just scholarship about women in sport and gender from the physical sciences to the social sciences. And that was one of the first times that I met Pat and Mariah Burton Nelson and other very significant sports scholars, and it was, I mean, I knew of Pat's work, and she was, I was doing stuff that was pretty cutting edge, but Pat was doing stuff about homophobia and lesbianism and backlash against women who were in the closet or trying to come out of the closet, so she was out there working without a net, and I greatly admired you for that then and now, because you were out there oftentimes all by yourself. Mm-hmm. So, not anymore.
No,
not
that's
anymore.
Right.
So that gives us a little historical context about your early work and how you met and how two preeminent scholars intersected and have a lifelong collegial relationship and friendship. And I think that's really nice. I'd like to take us back a little bit and provide some context and kind of counterweight to the positive and kind of rosy picture I painted in the introduction about women in sport. The work you've both done has illuminated the often difficult road that women in sport have encountered, from prejudice to homophobia to harassment and discrimination. So I'm going to start with you, Dr. Kane. Most of your research pertains to gender and its relations to power. And one of your pieces in the early 90s was about the sexual harassment that sports reporter Lisa Olson experienced in the locker room of the Patriots and the resulting vicious backlash that she encountered when she went public with her experience. So I'm curious, why did that particular incident attract your attention as a scholar?
Let me see. So for those of you who don't know, and many of you don't because you're students, and I know you probably weren't around in 1992 when this incident happened, and it was called an incident in the most of the media narrative. A sports reporter for the Boston Herald at that time was a woman named Lisa Olson, and she was a groundbreaking female reporter in that she was the beat reporter who went inside of the Patriots locker room. And what she reported is that she went in there one day and She was immediately surrounded by four or five naked male athletes who accused her of being, and I'm sorry to use this language, but who accused her of being a dick-watching bitch and basically sexually assaulted her. And she immediately left, and she reported it to her editor and hoped that it would not become public. But unfortunately, the rival paper, the Boston Globe, published a big expose about it. So there was this immediate media uproar, and it kind of went from, you know, of course that's what's going to happen. What was she doing there? She asked for it. What was she doing in a men's locker room? What's she so interested in men's bodies for, on the one hand, to the other part of the media narrative, which is she has every right to be here. This was sexual assault, and it was very inappropriate. But it became this big media uproar. And to answer Dr. Lavoie's question, I became, well, first of all, I was interested in it because I was a sport, media, and gender scholar. But also, I was at a conference, a sport management conference, and I was sitting in the session where people were talking about how you would handle some sort of public relations nightmare like this, and that it was a terrible thing because no one benefited from what had happened. And I remembered sitting in the audience thinking, that's not true. Male reporters benefited because if you intimidate female reporters, like you just like Lisa Olson was just intimidated, what female reporter is going to want to have that job? And male athletes who don't particularly want women in there benefit. So I thought the analysis was wrong. And so I came back to the University of Minnesota and started talking with my colleague named Lisa Dish, who was in political science. She's now at the University of Michigan. And we said, let's do a media analysis of why there was such a reaction to Lisa Olson. And I remembered thinking, you know, it's also not true that women are never in men's locker rooms. Women are in there as mothers. They're in there as girlfriends. They're in there as escorts. They're in there as trainers. They're in there as medical doctors. So they're in there to support males and to cheerlead for males. But when a woman reporter goes in, we argued, she goes in from a position of power that's pretty unique to women. And she had a position of power, we argued, for three reasons. One is that she goes into an inner sanctum of male privilege and power, and she is not invited and welcome. Two, she goes in there not to support men, but to critique their performance about something that they care a lot about. And it's not just about critiquing their success, it's also about critiquing their failure. And third, she has a public voice to talk about that performance. And so we did an analysis around that, and we did a media analysis around that. Okay, fast forward. Just by happenstance, there's an organization of women's sport reporters called AWSME, the Association for Women in Sports Media. Just as our article was hitting the papers and getting a little bit of traction within academic circles, the head of AWSME happened to be in St. Paul at the Pioneer Press, and their annual conference was here in Minneapolis. And so they invited my colleague and me to come and give our paper in front of these women sports reporters, all of whom were hot, Christine Brennan, I mean, all the major players, right? So right before we go on, the president pulls me aside, and also, by the way, there was all this media there, and I couldn't figure it out because we're academics, like, who cares what we say, right? And the president of AWSME pulls me aside to tell me that the reason that the media is here in part is because Lisa Olson, who had self-exiled to Australia because of the vicious backlash, had decided to come back to this conference, and it was her first public appearance in the United States since this had happened to her. And so I felt this enormous weight of giving this paper in front of these women, all of whom had been in men's locker rooms. I'd never been in a men's locker room. And I was very worried that we had the analysis wrong. And I remembered walking out on stage and giving this talk about what it meant for women to be harassed in men's locker rooms, and that it was about power and gender. And I could just feel the energy in the room, that these women reporters understood what we were saying. They understood our analysis. They agreed with what we were trying to say. And afterwards, Lisa Olson came up to me and looked me in the eyes with tears in her eyes and put her hand out and said, "Thank you, Dr. Kane." And I that happened in 1993, and I still remember it. And it, for me, was the very first time as an academic that I realized that the work that I was doing made a difference in people's lives. And that mattered to me more than anything I've ever done. So it's a long-winded story about Lisa Olson and that paper.
Mm-hmm. Well, the impact, I think as scholars, we never exactly know what the impact is, but that's a really concrete example of a real impact on a human being, and I'm sure she probably still remembers you as well. So speaking of impact, Dr. Griffin, you were one of the first scholars in the Academy, as Dr. Kane mentioned, to examine and talk about homophobia in sport at a time where really nobody was talking about it. And your work in the 80s and 90s culminated in the groundbreaking book, and then provocative, Strong Women, Deep Closets, which detailed the experience of lesbians in sport and the consequences of homophobia. The consequences of homophobia, not just for gay women, but for all women in sport. What motivated you to write this book?
Well, again, it was my own experience. I was an athlete high school and at the University of Maryland. And then I coached. I was a high school coach in the state of Maryland and then at the University of Massachusetts. And for all of that time, I was a very closeted lesbian. And so I carried around this incredible burden of secrecy and shame about who I was and fear that someone would find out who I was. And that included everyone, my parents, my coaches, my friends. I mean, it was just sort of a pervasive sense of this is a secret that I must carry to my grave. And it was a time, unlike now, fortunately, when you could actually believe that you were the only lesbian in the world. And I actually did believe that. And I found the word lesbian in a Dear Abby column. I have no idea why a 12-year-old girl is reading Dear Abby, but that's the first time I saw the word. And it struck terror into my heart because it gave me a label that named my experience, the feelings that I had. And then going into sports, it both saved my life because it was a place where I felt like I could be who I was. I could be somebody who was different. I could be an athlete. And so I really it sort of grew out of that, partly that my own experience, but I think even more directly, when I was coaching at the University of Massachusetts, and I was a swim coach, a women's swim coach.
Was this after your senior year?
Yes.
Okay.
I had graduated from college.
Okay, you were the real coach. All right, good.
I was an actual real coach then, being paid for it. Maybe.
Oh,
that
good.
So I was sort of creeping out of the closet at that point. Like, I had a circle of lesbian friends, and some of the athletes, I would start seeing them if I went to a dance in town. I'd run into women on the basketball team or the softball team or whatever. So word got around pretty quickly that this, Pat, the swim coach, is a lesbian. And so what started happening is that the athletes would start coming to me to talk. They would come when they broke up with their girlfriends. They would come and we'd shut the door to my office and they would cry. They would come if their parents...
Is that why these are out here?
That's right. That's for you.
Oh, okay.
And they would, if their parents had kicked them out of the house, they would come. And I was referring people to the counseling center. I had one friend there who I knew I could safely send them to that would take good care of them. And I started realizing these women are dealing with the same stuff that I was a generation ago. What's different? How are things going to change, if we don't start speaking out? And so I actually started a mission of making myself stronger so that I could be the person to speak out. And I know I spent several years sort of like, okay, I'm getting stronger. I'll do it soon. I'll speak out, and I'll come out, and I'll speak out, and I'll get stronger. I was at a lecture once that was given by this wonderful black lesbian activist from Boston. And she was quoting Audre Lorde, who was another amazing African-American lesbian writer and poet and activist. And all I remember from anything she said was the line, if we wait until we're not afraid, we'll be speaking from our graves. And it was like somebody, it was like, wow, thanks, I needed that. Because I knew that that's what I had been doing. I had been waiting until I wasn't afraid. And I suddenly realized that I have to speak out. And part of that speaking out for me was writing Strong Women, Deep Closets, because I wanted to write a book, much like, you know, Mary Jo talked about. I didn't just want it to be an academic book that would be read by sports scholars. I wanted to write a book that would be respected by sports scholars, but I wanted it to be a book that could be picked up by any coach or athlete who wanted to read a book that was about the experience of lesbian athletes and coaches and be able to relate to it. And so I wanted to write a book that was accessible and a book that would be able to change people's lives. And so that was how Strong Women, Deep Closets came about. Wow. Oh, and one more thing.
Yeah.
I gave a copy of an early draft to Mary Jo to read and to Mariah Burton Nelson. And both of them independently came back to me and said, Pat, where are you? You are not in this book. You have written a book. It's, you know, there are lots of really great things about this book, but there is nothing about you. I'd sort of let myself stay in the closet, writing the book about lesbian athletes being in the closet. And so they both said, you have to tell your story in the book. And so it kind of, you know, it's like, wow, that's right, I do. And it freed me up to make the first chapter of the book sort of talking about my own experience as a high school and college athlete who was very closeted, and my first initial experiences speaking out, where I could clear a room of women coaches like that by just saying the word lesbian, and they'd all sort of run for the exits. But that's how it all came about.
Yeah. Now we're a few years removed from the release of the book. Do you still get people coming up to you and talking about the book? I mean, I know I'm lending this book out to all, you know, for students doing research projects. It's well loved. So I know that in my circle we use it a lot, but are you still getting comments about this?
I do, and I'm very proud of that. That book was such a work of, you know, I used the word passion before, but again, personal passion. It had such personal meaning for me. And that is the most satisfying thing for me, when, particularly if it's, of course, young scholars, but if it's a coach or an athlete who comes up and says that the book helped them to understand their experience in a much broader social context, instead of just seeing it as my problem, you know, as a lesbian. It sort of put their experience into a broader context of sexism and homophobia and heterosexism and racism and, you know, broader systems of oppression and injustice. And that means so much to me, and it still does happen. I mean, it's bittersweet, because it's like, why is this still happening? Mm-hmm. And why, you know, this book should be irrelevant. It would be wonderful if it was completely a book that we can all look at and say, wow, remember when that book was important? But the fact that it's still relevant tells me that, you know, we still have work to do.
And I remember talking to you, I think it was a couple years ago, we were at the NCAA Inclusion Conference, and, you know, this is one of my most well-loved books. I'm like, so Pat, you wrote this book, it's really impactful. Tell me your secrets on how to write a book. Do you remember that?
Yes, I do.
And you remember what you said?
Well, I'm not exactly sure I remember, but I may have said to you that I just started to act like I was writing a book.
Yep, that's exactly what you said.
Because I thought, I can't write a book, how can I write a book?
Right.
And I just decided that the way to do it was just to start acting like I was writing a book.
Yeah.
So I did.
And I can tell you that your advice worked.
All right.
So thank you for that. And actually, it's done. So I appreciated that advice. As simple as it sounded, it's right. All right, back to you, Dr. Kane.
Okay.
So certainly with the Lisa Olson piece is fairly well known, but you're really most well known for your sport media research over the last 25 years on the portrayals of female athletes, as Pat was referring to, with the images, the powerful images of women in the sport media. So can you talk a little bit about some of your recent work that you and I have done together with Professor Janet Fink at UMass around this idea that sex sells women's sport? And particularly in light of my introduction, what are the key contributions of this work that might help us explain the growing and record viewership of women's sports?
Mm-hmm. Well, can I do a slight little tributary away from, before I get to the sex cells?
Yes.
Okay. So, because this is a classic for me, Minnesota story. So early in my career here at the University of Minnesota, and it's true, as Pat said earlier, I would go all over the country, all over the state of Minnesota with then my slide projector. I remember being up on the Iron Range, and I was among a group of women, professional women, older women, who, you know, I thought would generally be pretty sympathetic to my concerns about how female athletes were being sexually portrayed. And so I was going through my slideshow, and the audience was just like completely flat. And I'm pretty good at reading an audience. And I'm like, okay, I'm like dying up here. What is going on? And I remembered finishing, and there was sort of a tepid, polite, respectful, but tepid response. And I was like, okay, any questions? And a woman in the back stood up and said, yeah, I have a question, Dr. Kane. I said, okay. She said, this is appalling. So what are we going to do about it? And I remember thinking, like a deer in headlights, what are we going to do about it? I mean, I'm an academic. I don't really know how to do anything about anything. And I remember driving home from the Iron Range going, that's a really good question. So what are we going to do about it? And one of the things that we did about it at the Tucker Center was to form a partnership with TPT Channel 2 Public Television, and we produced two award-winning documentaries, one of which actually on media coverage of female athletes really did win an Emmy. And the person who helped co-produce this, who is sitting in the audience, without whom we would not have an Emmy, let alone an incredible documentary on media images of female athletes, is none other than Sherry Lamke. So would you please stand up and get an applause for... Related to that, so one of the things that we talk about in the documentary is related to giving these presentations all over the country and all over the world, is that and I have given them before friendly audiences, unbelievably hostile audiences. But at the end, the very first question that I would always get, either in support of what I was saying or challenging what I was saying, was, well, Dr. Kane, whether you like it or not, sex sells women's sports. And that would be the showstopper. It would just end everything. And I remembered having another long drive home from somewhere thinking, we don't have any data on whether or not sex sells women's sports. I know the literature cold. There are no data on if you present females as sex objects 1 year, and then the next year market them as highly competent athletes, you know, and then you compare viewership, corporate sponsorship, attendance. I mean, we don't have any data. And when I would talk to marketing folks or sports information directors and I would ask them if they had any data, they didn't have any data either. And so I had rolling around in my head, how are we going to do a study that will empirically address whether or not it's true that sex sells women's sports? And I knew I had to be so methodologically tight and rigorous because nobody had ever done it. People would pounce on it. So I knew it had to be cold. The method had to be cold. The analysis had to be cold. The theory had to be cold, meaning good, solid. And so I wanted to also work with people who were great and who got it and were fabulous scholars, one of whom is sitting right over here to my right. So with Dr. Lavoie and Janet Fink at UMass Amherst, we did the first ever study where we actually had focus groups and we randomly presented them with images of female athletes ranging from on-court competence to off-court sexy babes. And we asked them, what makes you most interested in women's sports? What makes you most respect women's sports? And big surprise, images of females who were athletically competent were embraced by fans, males as well as females, particularly dads with daughters, who deeply resented how young women were being portrayed. And again, what was helpful to me about this research is that we then finally had empirical data to counter the argument that sex sells women's sports. I realize it's an isolated study. I encourage people everywhere to replicate the study. But one of the things that happened 2 summers ago is that because of this research, I was invited to be at the conference of the American Association of Sports Editors. So I was able to show these images and show the data, because I really believe at the end of the day that unless those sports editors see that it is in their self-interest to portray women in ways that the audience wants to see, that it's actually counterproductive because it offends people when you see these kinds of images. That, again, it linked our research mm-hmm. to key decision makers who could make a difference about how women are portrayed in the media, and I think they're finally starting to get it. One other thing, if you just take a look at how female athletes in the WNBA used to be portrayed in marketing campaigns versus how they're portrayed now, it's no difference. And one other little anecdote with the media, I was being once interviewed by a reporter who was asking me about my research, being critical of how the media portrayed female athletes. And he said to me, well, Dr. Kane, don't you think one of the reasons that we portray female athletes as kind of sexy babes is that as a reporter and a photographer, you're always looking for kind of a different angle, something that not anybody sort of ever does. You kind of want that different angle. And I said, well, if that's the case, I have an idea. Why don't you portray female athletes as athletes? Because that would be a different angle. And then the interview kind of, and he crushed me. But, you know, what are you going to do?
But I think using that, the sex doesn't sell women's sport data has given us a nice platform to mm-hmm. talk to decision makers, from sports editors to people that run professional sport leagues to ESPN and ESPNW. And, you know, in the intro, when I was going through all these amazing accomplishments of female athletes, the reason why people were watching these women is because they're amazing athletes.
Right.
And I'd like to think that in part that owners and media decision makers are finally getting it, because they know when they increase the number of games they show on TV for the WNBA or women's college basketball or volleyball or softball, that it impacts their bottom line. They're not doing it because it's the right thing to do. It's a smart business decision. And I think our data has sort of helped push them, I hope, in the right direction. We'll
right.
continue to feed them more data as we get it.
Right.
Can I say something?
Yeah.
It just seems like an appropriate moment to have a commercial break. I don't know if you here at the University of Minnesota totally appreciate how amazing the Tucker Center is. And so I just want to say, someone who is not from Minnesota, who is from the East Coast and who gives presentations all over the country on LGBT issues and women's issues in sports, the Tucker Center has such respect from other people, not only practitioners, coaches, and administrators who can use the data that is generated here, but also sports scholars from around the world. And you are so lucky to have this kind of access to this kind of a resource that does this amazingly important and groundbreaking work right here in Minnesota. So just a little
wow.
commercial break for you all.
Totally.
Absolutely.
And that's a wrap. I do have a few more questions for both of you. This is so fun. So Dr. Griffin, in the intro, I pointed to some landmark firsts for women's sport leaders in professional sports, including coaches. And counter to that is a statement that you made recently in a Huffington Post op-ed you wrote, that college athletics is waging a war on women coaches. So it's a really strong statement. Can you talk about why you made that strong and controversial statement and what that means in light of our tipping point conversation?
Mm-hmm. Yes. The data, many of the data that you all have generated here at the Tucker Center, as well as other researchers, tell us that there's clearly a decline in the number of women coaching women's sports. I mean, I think that 60% of women's collegiate teams now are coached by men. So that means only 40% of women's teams are coached by women. And by the same token, I think there's only, 1 or 2% of men's teams are coached by women. So, mm-hmm. you know, we had some amazing examples of changes that have happened just recently. But that's a pretty amazing statistic to think that women, if you look at the whole picture, actually have only access to about 25% of the coaching, total coaching positions. And and so, you know, that for me is a problem because I think young women need role models. They need women to see women in leadership positions. And then when you look at the administrators, it's athletic administrators, it's the same thing. There are very few women in leadership positions in athletic departments in colleges. I think Division I schools, 11%, something like that?
Yeah, I don't even know if it's that high.
And you know, I in the big, the five, the Power Five athletic conferences, I think there are three. University of
North Carolina State,
Rutgers, and Penn State.
Right.
And that's it.
And one interim.
And an interim. Right. And exactly.
And an interim.
Beth Goetz, University of Minnesota. All right.
Yes.
Go Gophers.
And so that's a problem because, you know, you have to ask the question, why are women not getting these positions? And, you know, again, the Tucker Center is taking the lead to try to do some research to help us answer that question. But I think when I talk to young coaches, assistant coaches in particular, they feel like that athletics is, and I actually believe a lot of it has to do with the arms race in men's basketball and football, you know, how much money is being spent at the major colleges that puts pressure on athletic departments to hire athletic leaders.
Excuse me.
Whose primary goal is to fundraise for men's basketball and football. And, you know, all other sports, I think, tend to be sort of put into a second-class category. So that, you have to factor that in. And I think that, you know, factoring in, there's still this underlying issue of homophobia. I think there's concerns about lesbians in coaching, even though I think we've made great progress in terms of higher visibility of lesbian athletes at the college level and at the professional level. The same support is not there for lesbian coaches. I think the one statistic tells it all. I cannot name one publicly out Division I women's coach in all of college sports. I mean, I know that there are coaches who are publicly out in their communities, out to their teams, and the parents of their athletes on their teams, but that's an amazing statistic, given the assumptions that people make about lesbians and sport and how sport is such a, it's a place where lesbians can be comfortable being out. But, if that was really true, then there would be more lesbians who are publicly out mm-hmm. and not fearful of what being out, you know, what kind of consequences that would have on their jobs. And more recently, over the last year or two, we've had some really disturbing situations where coaches, University of Iowa, the field hockey coach, more recently here in Minnesota, the University of Minnesota Duluth ice hockey coach, Shannon Miller, who has, you know, won 5 national championships. She coached the Canadian national team. And she was suddenly fired. And both of those are involved in lawsuits now with their universities. And it's a mix of women who stand up and challenge gender inequities in their schools. Sometimes it's, you know, it's lesbians who are standing up for, you know, who want to be publicly out, like Shannon Miller. But it really brings into question whether or not we really are making progress in women's sports when women are afraid to be who they are or are afraid to fight for equality in terms of men's and women's sports when these kinds of things are happening. So I really believe that there are some underlying issues of gender bias that are so strong in athletics. You know, we talked about how, you know, sport is still considered a male domain. And you can see that in terms of the media attention, you know, where the resources go. And to that extent, you know, to the extent that women are still struggling to find a place in sport where they can be perceived as equals is disturbing. And And a lot of it, I think, is underlying gender bias. And sometimes I don't even think that athletic directors know they're making, you know, they're judging women and men differently. Mm-hmm. I think there's a double standard for, you know, if you're a man and you throw the water bottle during the game, or, you know, you stomp your feet and, you know, you're tough and demanding, that's what a coach should be. But if you're a woman and you do the same thing, you're perceived as inappropriate or abusive. And so there are double standards for how men and women are judged sometimes in athletics. It's almost so under the surface, we don't even realize that it's happening. Or some people don't realize that it's happening. But I think that it really gives me pause when you have to stop and think about how much progress have we really made. I know we've made progress, but we still have to dig deeper to, you know, root out all those gender biases that are holding women back in terms of getting the coaching positions, being able to hang on to those positions and be recognized.
Mm-hmm. Did you get any backlash from writing that op-ed and having such a strong title?
No, I didn't. Maybe, you know, nobody said anything to me. Mostly what I got was feedback from women who were glad that somebody was calling attention to it.
Right.
And particularly sort of, I laid out like 5 or 6 or 7 situations around the country where women had, you know, been fired, not rehired, or, you know, were being judged by what looks like different standards from male coaches in the same schools. Mm-hmm. Because I wanted to point out this is not just one incident here or one incident there. It's a real pattern.
It's a systemic issue, yeah. And I think in that piece you made a really concise point that this is the intersection of sexism and homophobia.
And misogyny, I believe, which is an even deeper disrespect for women in athletics, which I think is evident in how we handle sexual assault or sexual harassment by male athletes. You know, we protect, you know, often the instinct is to protect the male athlete and not believe the woman. Mm-hmm. And so I think that there are lots of different ways that gets played out in athletics that I think we need to root out and pay attention to.
Well, thank you for writing that piece. It's something I often cite, and I thought it was, you hit the analysis right on the head. Dr. Kane, in my opening remarks, I pointed to, you know, a lot of these amazing athletic achievements of female athletes that are considered the best, period. Not the best female athletes, the best athletes. And another article that you're often cited and known for and still used in the classroom is your 95 groundbreaking, what we call the sport continuum piece, where you made the argument that sport performance is a continuum, not a binary, where all men outperform all women. And when we construct this as a binary, men are privileged and women athletes are marginalized and contained. And I remember reading it as a graduate student thinking, much like Dr. Griffin's book, wow, this is really eye-opening. And a lot of things just made sense. So you were really the first to argue that sport performance is a continuum. How did you get there? Because nobody was making that argument at the time.
How did I get there? Well, so I didn't really know very much about marathons, and have never lived in New York or Boston. And when I first moved here, I live on the Parkway. And so the Twin Cities Marathon comes by my house. And when I was first here, moved here into the neighborhood in the early 90s, we were outside and we were watching, you know, literally thousands of runners. And this is not like the B team marathon. This is a very good marathon, very elite athletes. And all of the folks who were in my neighborhood, you know, we'd go out and we'd, you know, clap, clap, clap as people came by. And a lot of my friends, male and female, were talking about how great it was that the muscle gap every year was being closed, and that the marathon was great because, you know, women were really good and they could also run really well. And but again, I thought to myself, I think we're missing something here, because have you ever noticed how when we make all these gender comparisons when the race is taking place, right? So we compare the front-running males and the front-running females. But the minute the first male crosses the finish line, those gender comparisons stop. We don't, yes, it's true that 40 to 45 men just finished ahead of the first female runner, but did you ever notice how that first female runner just outperformed several thousand males who are running behind her on the same course at the same day in the same sport? And so I thought, it's not true that there's this binary. It is not true that all males, by definition, outperform all females, because we just witnessed a situation right before our eyes where females were outperforming males. And so I started to think about sport as not this oppositional binary, but as a continuum where you have males and females performing. And it's true that as we currently practice sports, that on one end of the continuum in individual sports, you're going to have more females clustered there. And as we get towards the other end of team combat-oriented sports that glorify and exemplify the most extreme possibilities of the male body, males will tend to cluster there. And then what we do is socially blow those differences out, because you're never in a situation where you say, oh my God, that guy is just getting too big. He's just getting too big. He needs to get smaller. I mean, he does. Whereas for women, it's often a very difficult situation, because to occupy a traditional female body is very different from what it means to occupy sometimes a really strong, powerful, athletic body. So I started thinking about sport as a continuum of physical activity. But one of the things that I was aware of as somebody who was a theorist, hearkening back to the days of John Loy, my mentor at Illinois, who was a supreme theorist, is if you follow the continuum to its logical extension and you say, we are no longer going to practice sports around a gendered binary, we're no longer going to have men's sports and women's sports, we're just going to have a sport continuum, what's the logical extension of that theory or conclusion? What do we end up with? Class? Sorry, what do we end up with?
One team.
One hockey team. One basketball team. And so you end up with a situation where the very people that you're trying to create opportunities for and expand boundaries for as we practice sports today would end up hurting them. And so that's why, in many ways, it's good to be an academic and a theorist, because you don't have to actually do anything with it. But nevertheless, I think that the other piece of that argument was, in order for the established order, meaning males as the majority group, to maintain power, you have to suppress knowledge of a continuum where women, in fact, do outperform men in the same sport sometimes. Because here's another logical conclusion that you can come to suppress the idea of sport as a gendered binary. And there were things that I called mechanisms of containment to contain any evidence of a continuum versus a binary. And I'll just give you one example. I had four, but I'll just, in the interest of time, give you one, because it's related to the marathon. We have what's operating out there, as an academic, called a selective gender comparison. Again, where you say, in the marathon, you selectively compare the front-running men to the front-running women until the first male crosses the finish line, and then you no longer have that comparison. But here's another thing to think about. It's called the social fact mechanism, and it is this. It is a fact that Serena Williams cannot beat the best male tennis players. I think it's an uncontested fact that Serena Williams, in many ways the best female tennis player ever, cannot beat Djokovic or Murray. And I'm going to look at Judge Margaret Chutich out there, a tennis player. Would you agree with that, Margaret? Okay. That is an uncontested fact. Here is an equally uncontested fact, that Serena Williams can beat the vast majority of males who play tennis, even really elite male tennis players. Now, I am not saying that the first fact should not be privileged over the second fact. I'm not saying that at all. I'm not saying that we should do the politically correct thing and ignore that fact. But what I am saying is, let's think about the logical conclusion. If this is the only comparison that we ever think about and hear about and know about, the logical conclusion to that piece is, no matter how good a female is, she can never beat a male. If we focus also on this fact, however, the logical conclusion is, some women can beat almost all men. Now imagine what your life would be like if you walked around with that in your head, or what it would be like if little girls grew up with that in their head rather than this in their head. And I think that that would be a significant and fundamental change, which is why I think it's terribly important that for the status quo to be maintained, you must suppress evidence of that continuum. So theoretically, it's okay. It worked. Mm-hmm. That's it. That's my deal. That's my continuum argument.
It also has implications for the participation of transgender athletes,
yeah, absolutely,
and intersex athletes, which is another way in which the binary is problematic, you know, sort of assuming that the category of man and woman are completely separate and non-overlapping. And that's, you know, in trying to create policies that enable transgender athletes to participate in the gender that they identify with, this is the same thing. What we're trying to do is to stretch the categories to create space for transgender people to participate, but at the same time maintain the opportunity for girls and women to have the maximum opportunities to play. Mm-hmm. So the continuum fits there too.
Yes.
I'm glad you brought that up. And I think, Dr. Griffin, you're so well known across the country and around the world for your advocacy and your workshops and your seminars with coaches and athletic administrators, and I know you still do quite a bit of traveling around that, and you have been doing that for 30 plus years, and it has made an impact. I'm curious, over, you know, the last couple decades, from when you first started to now, what kinds of resistance do you still face, and what do you see has changed?
Oh, wow, so much has changed. I think of myself and mostly as an advocate now. I feel like I'm an educator and an advocate, not so much a scholar like Dr. Kane or you. Because most of my work now is concentrated on working with practitioners, coaches, athletic administrators about lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender inclusion in sport. And when I first started doing that work, I would walk into a group of coaches, college coaches, and they'd all come in, and nobody really wanted to be there, and everybody was kind of nervous because, you know, most of them, I felt like we had to start off with having them all say in unison, lesbian, gay, because they just couldn't even get the words out. And usually the men were kind of resentful because they didn't, you know, they didn't see any reason for them to be there because, of course, there were no gay men in sports. And the women were sort of divided, and the closeted lesbians were mostly terrified that somehow by participating they would be outed to their colleagues. And the straight women were sort of resentful that everybody thought they were lesbians because they were coaches. So it was a pretty strange environment. And I felt like my job basically was to try to convince them that this was an issue that they should even pay attention to. And it was very difficult to get conversations going. And I often felt as if I had to figure out a different way to try to get the conversations going because they were so tough. Around 10 years ago, and I can actually mark it, I was doing a workshop with the coaches at Cal Poly in San Luis Obispo. And I always had these little like scenarios that I'd ask them to work with because I didn't want them to feel like, it felt like it gave them a little bit of distance to talk about typical situations that would come up and enable them to have the conversations without it being, you know, feeling like it was about them, you know. So I was using those as sort of a buffer to create the space for them to have conversations. And so I pulled my little scenarios out with these coaches, and hands started going up. and another hand's going up. And so I just ripped them up and threw them over my shoulder because they were ready to talk. It was like a shift had occurred. And both the men and the women coaches understood that they had lesbian, gay, and bisexual. We weren't talking about transgender athletes then, but they knew that they had people on their team who identified as LGB. And so they had questions. They wanted to know what to do. And so it was a real turning point, and it was about 10 years ago when I started noticing that. And now I feel like the biggest challenge is the vast majority of coaches that I work with really have the intention of making their teams a place that LGBT athletes can feel safe and respected and included. The gap now is in knowing what to do. So we talk about real issues that they are sort of concerned about. For example, the biggest issue when I work with coaches of women's teams is, what do I do if I have two teammates who are dating? That's like a big deal. Mm-hmm. And you know, it's kind of like, and it's funny, some of them, it's like, look, I made it safe, we were inclusive, and now look what's happening, they're dating each other. And what am I supposed to do about that? And so, or you know, sometimes with the men's teams, it's more of an issue of like sort of casual name calling. You know, you fag this and, you know, pussy that and that kind of thing. And so, and it's become embedded in men's sports culture in some ways. And I don't think often when men throw those terms around in those situations, they're actually thinking there might be a gay man on the team mm-hmm. who hasn't come out and with the effect that that kind of language would have on him. And so we talk about that. You know, we talk about what if I have some Christian athletes who think homosexuality is a sin, and I have some out lesbians or gay men. What, you know, what am I supposed to do? So we really get to talk now about actual ways that they can enact their intention to make their teams inclusive places. And so that's pretty exciting to be able to do that.
Yeah, and a panel of yours that I sat in on a couple years ago where you purposely brought together yourself and the leader, and I can't remember her name, of the Fellowship of Christian Athletes to have a conversation about this intersection of, you know, how do we try to be inclusive with religion and sexual identity. And that was really a fascinating panel, and I applaud you for being the first one to, you know, do that work. And it's interesting now when we run the Women Coaches Symposium and we get feedback, you know, what could we offer next year? We're having coaches actually ask for a workshop on inclusion because, you know, they realize they have a deficit of skills or tools in their pocket to deal with this. So I think your work has had a dramatic impact.
Thank you. Yeah. And there's such an incredible generational shift. I always tell the athletes when I work with them, they are way ahead of their coaches. They are way more comfortable, and you know, there are many more college athletes on men's and women's teams who are out to their teammates, and everybody's like, fine, no problem. The coaches and the administrators are the ones who are uncomfortable.
Right.
Okay, so within the interest of time, I have a couple more really good questions, but let's wrap it up. I'm going to give you one more question each. This is the million-dollar question, all right? So given this conversation tonight and all the issues that we've talked about and the introduction from earlier tonight about the groundbreaking work that's happening in women's athletics, juxtaposed with your own work on harassment and discrimination and homophobia and power, how do we answer this question? Have we reached a tipping point for women's sport or not?
In a word, no. but, no, and. I don't know that there are, first of all, to use the continuum analogy, there are many tipping points. And I think that we've seen a fundamental shift over the last 10 years in all of the four categories that you mentioned, Dr. LaVoy, at the beginning. I do think that there have been fundamental shifts. I do think that we are at tipping points that we will be able to look back on as very significant markers. But this is the trap that I found us falling into when I got calls from the press, as I'm sure the two of you did as well, about is this a tipping point? Is this a tipping point? Because again, think about this, the way that it gets framed innocently makes complete logical sense, but the way the tipping point gets framed is to compare men's sports to women's sports. And I have always believed that that is just not a fair, it's a false comparison, it's a false equivalency in this sense, given what it has meant in this culture for women to participate in sports, starting with Pat and me as tomboys, and how females for a very long time until very recently were deeply stigmatized for what it meant to be an elite female athlete. Whereas for males, it was just, you know, you were stigmatized if you didn't want to be an athlete, right? And so I'm not saying that we should therefore go down to City Hall and protest. I'm just making the point that when you compare men's sports to women's sports, what you're doing is actually, you think you're comparing apples to apples, but you're actually comparing apples to oranges. It would be like comparing a tech startup company to Apple. And so I think that as long as the comparison is framed with, is this a tipping point for women compared to where women used to be, as opposed to, is this a tipping point comparing men and women to each other right now? If we could frame it that way, I would say it's absolutely a tipping point, but I just want us to be on guard because it is the most human, natural comparison to make, and you have to stop yourself from making that comparison. I mean, I get why we do it, and I want that to ultimately be the comparison that we make, but I think it becomes a slippery slope. Mm-hmm. So.
Thank you.
Well, I think, you know, social change is never smooth sailing on a nice linear trajectory. I think it's any social change in any arena, on any social justice issue, whether you're talking about racism, sexism, heterosexism, ableism, it doesn't matter. It's jagged. You know, it goes. You know, you make some progress and then you know you take a step back. Somebody pushes. There's backlash. There's pushback. And I think this will be the same. I think I'd rather than tipping points, I would like to call it. These are the things you talked about in the beginning are really important milestones that we should celebrate. And be prepared that it doesn't mean that suddenly all of the obstacles to women's opportunities to have coaching opportunities, to have sporting opportunities will suddenly blossom forth because of all of these milestones that have happened. I think we have to remain vigilant and you've used the word power several times. I think there's always pushback. When any socially disadvantaged group tries to push forward and achieve equality and social justice, there's pushback. And there will be pushback to these milestones as well.
Mm-hmm. Can I just do one quick thing, because I know you want to get to the Q&A, because I don't know that we've paid enough homage to what really was a tipping point in women's sports, and that's the passage of Title IX. Without that law, we wouldn't be even having this conversation. And when people ask me what has been the impact of Title IX, I think a nice way to talk about it is that, again, going back to our histories and a lot of the histories of the women in this room who were pre-Title IX tomboys, just think about this, folks. In two generations, we've gone from young girls hoping that there is a team to young girls hoping that they make the team. And that has been the real tipping point in women's sports. So that's my...
Okay.
Statement.
So we have multiple tipping points or a jagged edge of push and pull. Maybe we should have renamed this from the beginning, but I think that's very insightful. So to wrap it up, as we always do, I'm going to look at my watch here. We have time for a few questions. We have Anna and Marnie who have roving mics. So if you have a question, raise your hand. You have to speak into the mic because we're taping this. So don't just start shouting. So, who has a question?
I can't see. Some students out there could have a question. Extra credit. Mike Mueller has a question.
Right down here, Marnie, in the front.
Can you see, Marnie?
One of the things you brought up was that there are fewer women coaches of women's sports. are there fewer because the women's coaches started getting equal pay and the men wanted in?
That's one hypothesis.
That's one contributing factor, or hypothesis.
And I think that's one of the effects of Title IX, is that women's coaching positions were being paid more. When I was coaching high school, I was a volunteer. The women were not paid at all. And now it pays better. And so I think that is one piece
of
the puzzle.
They're hired by men?
Beg your pardon?
At the college level, most coaches are hired by males. Is there a connection?
There is a connection in this sense. I think that because the vast majority of athletic directors are males, whoever they hire, it's going to be mostly by men. But again, prior to Title IX, it wasn't just the number of head coaches that were mostly female, it was also most of the athletic administrators were also female as well. So one of the great ironies of Title IX, and I know that Title IX has critics, and that's a whole other session, is that the notion that Title IX has been hard on men's sports because it's forced schools to drop men's non-revenue sports. That may or may not be true. We can debate that. But what is incontrovertible is that as an employment track, men now have, as a result of Title IX, a dual career employment track as coaches and as administrators, and women do not have the same dual career track because they're not making inroads as coaches in men's sports as men have made into women's sports. So is that a fair
assessment? That is right on.
Assessment.
Cold. One more question. Matt?
I can't. There's a woman, too.
One over here?
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, so Julie and I had a question for Dr. Kane.
Oh.
Just based on your information and kind of findings with Lisa, Patriots, female reporters in male locker rooms, have you found that female reporters have increased nowadays, per se, in male locker rooms, or kind of where is that now?
Yes, I do think, and in fact, if anything, I think that the Lisa Olson incident really made people realize that this was really an issue of occupational employment, and that you couldn't sexually harass somebody in the workplace, because when those women reporters entered that locker room, they were entering into a workplace space. And you have many more women reporters now who are not only columnists but beat reporters. Again, not comparable to the number of male sports reporters, but infinitely better than what it used to be in the Lisa Olson days, if you will. Yeah.
ESPN did a wonderful documentary a couple summers ago for their 30 for 30 series on female reporters, sports reporters. It was really well done. I'm sure it's available
online. It's called Let Them Wear Towels.
Yeah.
Yes.
Clever.
It's actually very good. That's good. I forgot about that.
Okay, last question, Matt.
So you talked about possibly being a tipping point and maybe more towards a milestone. Talked about the push and the pull. I'm going to let you project a little bit, talk about where does it go from here? You've seen a lot throughout history, and it may not be smooth. Maybe talk a little bit about where you see this going.
Thanks, Matt. That was one of the questions I skipped.
Well, I'm an optimist. I think that, I think things are not going to completely revert back to the way they used to be. I think that we will keep inching toward equality in sport. I think in terms of LGBT participation in sport, I think we've made some incredibly rapid progress over the last several years. Pushback, like I think Michael Sam is a perfect example of the first NFL draft pick to try out for a team. He didn't quite make it. But others will come and follow, and I think we'll continue to make progress, on those issues. In women's sports, we have coaches like Joel Ellis, the coach of the World Cup Championship soccer team, is an out lesbian. That would never have happened, you know, before. And she provides a role model for other women who, you know, will be following in her footsteps. So I think we're going to continue to make the progress. I just think that that's never a smooth journey. And I think the research that people like Mary Jo and Nicole are doing, that are providing some real data around the women's coaches issues and sex cells and the other research you've been doing is going to, that's going to be huge in terms of keeping these issues on the forefront and providing opportunities for practitioners to be able to see that data and continue to make the progress.
And I'm actually very optimistic as well. I mean, you know, I do tend to think in terms of power dynamics, which I think comes out of a discipline of sociology. But I think if we think of the issue of whether or not females should participate in sports, even at the most elite levels, that has fundamentally been erased from the radar screen. We will not go back to that. So I think the first beachhead was, should girls and women play sports up and down the food chain within a large critical mass? And I think the next sort of beachhead will be women having powerful administrative roles, coaching roles, not just in women's sports, but also in men's sports. And we're starting to see little cracks there. And I think what's particularly powerful about that is there are few, and I know I'm biased, I'm a homer here, but there are few institutions in this country that we worship more, and I am one of the worshipers of this thing called sports. And what is so important about this as sport as an institution is that when the whole country sees women occupying these positions of power and seeing female athletes engage at the most elite levels of competition and succeeding in the most high-stake, high-pressure, grace-under-pressure moments, it not only has an impact on how we think about women and men and gender relations in sports, but in society overall. And that is a really beautiful, wonderful thing. So I think we're going to be okay, you guys. We're going to be okay. And nobody who knows me would ever think I would ever end by saying something like that. But it's true. It's true.
It's true.
It's true, right?
So for those who are in the audience, I hope you've taken home some insights. And join me in applauding and acknowledging two of the best scholars in the world. Thank you. And I would like
reception.
To now invite all of you for a reception out in the entryway where you can continue to connect and converse. Thank you for coming.